New York, this is Democracy Now!
Our tax system is broken. Everywhere you look, there is one set of rules for most Americans and a different set of rules for the richest people. One of the most glaring examples of this is how the tax code treats wealth.
A major leak of IRS tax filings has revealed multi-billionaires Jeff Bezos, Elon Musk, Warren Buffett, Michael Bloomberg, George Soros have all avoided paying any federal income tax some years, even as their wealth soared. We'll speak to a reporter from ProPublica who broke the story. Then to Takeover, a new documentary looks back at how the young lords took over a hospital in the South Bronx in 1970.
Our plan was to take over Lincoln Hospital.
We have to begin to stand up for the people, the Puerto Rican people, and say that's enough. That's enough.
We've been asking for changes to take place. And you've paid no attention to us. You've thrown us out of your offices. And you've called the cops on us. Now we're putting you out. You've taken over a hospital. We're going to run it. You're out.
We'll speak to the director of Takeover, as well as our own Juan Gonzalez, co-founder of the Young Lords, who helped organize the action. Plus, we look at the shocking treatment of migrant children in U.S. custody. Video has emerged of officials in Texas tasering a 16-year-old boy from Honduras. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Vice President Kamala Harris wrapped up her visit to Latin America Tuesday after meeting with Mexican President Andrés Manuel López Obrador and praising the new era of bilateral relations between the two countries. The U.S. and Mexico have vowed to continue their joint efforts in blocking asylum seekers from reaching the border, for which Mexico has long received U.S. funding. Asylum seekers crossing through Mexico often face deadly violence and racism from Mexican authorities and organized crime. Harris has also come under fire for not yet visiting the U.S.-Mexico border. She was questioned Tuesday by NBC News anchor Lester Holt.
So this whole thing about the border, we've been to the border. We've been to the border.
You haven't been to the border.
I haven't been to Europe. And I don't understand the point that you're making.
In related news, over 2,000 children ripped from their families at the U.S.-Mexico border might still be separated from their parents. This according to a Homeland Security report. It found nearly 4,000 children were subject to the Trump administration's family separation policy. A Biden administration task force set up to reunite families has so far reunified just 7 children. In more related news, CNN's reporting U.S. border agents have been deployed to Cancun, Mexico, to serve and detain travelers in the southern coastal city whom they suspect of being asylum seekers headed to the U.S. In other immigration news, Canadian media and data giant Thomson Reuters is facing mounting pressure to end its contracts with Immigration and Customs Enforcement, or ICE. Reuters just signed a new multi-million-dollar contract with ICE for a car license plate reader to help the agency track the movement of vehicles across the country. Until recently, Reuters also provided ICE with a software called Clear, which helps surveil and consolidate the public records of immigrants who could then be targeted for deportation. Reuters is holding an annual shareholders meeting today. Activists are calling on investors to demand the board cut ties with ICE. The immigrant justice group Mi Gente, which has been leading the campaign, said, quote, this tech continues facilitating deportations and raids, leading to terrorized and distraught immigrant communities across the U.S. It must end, they said. In Washington, D.C., President Biden cut off talks with Senate Republicans on what he hoped would be a bipartisan compromise on his infrastructure plan after weeks of failed negotiations. Republicans have rejected proposals to raise taxes on corporations and the ultra-wealthy to help fund the plan. The White House says Biden's moving on to talks with another group of bipartisan senators in the hopes of salvaging his bill. Meanwhile, the so-called Problem Solvers Caucus, made up of dozens of bipartisan House members, are proposing a $1.2 trillion spending package. Biden's embarking on a week-long trip to Europe today, which will include the G7 summit. Prominent civil rights groups and leaders met with West Virginia Senator Joe Manchin Tuesday in the hopes of convincing the conservative Democrat to support the For the People Act, a sweeping bill to protect voting rights at the federal level. Manchin said the talks did not change his opposition, despite having co-sponsored the bill just 2 years ago in 2019, even though it also received no Republican support at the time. Manchin is now claiming the lack of bipartisan support is his reason for opposing the bill. He's instead suggested he would vote for a limited bipartisan-supported John Lewis Voting Rights Act. But on Tuesday, Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell came out against the John Lewis Act, calling it unnecessary. Reverend Dr. William Barber announced the Poor People's Campaign will hold a moral march on Manchin in West Virginia next Monday. CNBC reports Americans for Prosperity, a lobbying group backed by billionaire Charles Koch, has been pressuring Manchin to oppose key Democratic legislative efforts, including filibuster reform and voting rights legislation. Meanwhile, Tuesday, Senate Republicans blocked the Paycheck Fairness Act, which seeks to remedy the gender wage gap, leading to yet more calls to abolish the filibuster. A report released Tuesday by two Senate committees listed a range of security failures leading up to the deadly insurrection at the U.S. Capitol. Capitol Police received intelligence warnings that armed Trump extremists would try to storm the building at least 2 weeks before the January 6th riot, but failed to take any action or properly disseminate the information. Democratic Senator Gary Peters of Michigan stated, quote, "The attack was quite frankly planned in plain sight," he said. In related news, Trump's defense lawyers during his second impeachment trial are defending at least three people who've been charged in connection with the Capitol insurrection. A more transmissible variant of the coronavirus, first identified in India, known as the Delta variant, now represents around 6% of infections in the U.S. In Britain, the rapidly spreading Delta variant is causing officials to weigh whether to fully reopen the country. White House coronavirus advisor Dr. Anthony Fauci said, however, two doses of the Pfizer vaccine or the AstraZeneca vaccine appear to be highly effective in combating it. The Centers for Disease Control issued new travel guidelines for over 120 countries with separate advice for vaccinated and unvaccinated travelers. 33 countries, including Israel and Singapore, have been moved to the lowest risk level, while the CDC recommends against non-essential travel for unvaccinated people to countries including Mexico, Russia, and Iran. Brazil and India are in the highest threat category, meaning travel should be avoided. A sweeping international sting operation has led to over 800 arrests and the seizure of drugs and tens of millions of dollars. The arrest came after the FBI and Australian law enforcement developed their own encrypted device company, Anum, which was then used by organized crime networks in over 100 countries. This is acting U.S. Attorney for Southern California, Randy Grossman.
The criminal users didn't know that for more than 18 months, the FBI captured more than 27 million messages between users around the world who had their criminal discussions reviewed, recorded, and translated by the FBI.
A United Nations official is warning of possible mass deaths, illness, and starvation in Burma after an estimated 100,000 people had to flee military attacks in eastern Kaya State. The UN is calling for immediate action to prevent further tragedy as the Burmese military continues its indiscriminate attacks on ethnic groups and protesters who've been taking to the streets since the February 1st military coup. In El Salvador, a woman serving a 30-year prison sentence accused of having an abortion has been released after nearly a decade behind bars. Sara Rojel was arrested in 2012 after she went to the hospital with bleeding injuries she said she sustained after a fall. Rojel, then a 22-year-old student, was prosecuted and sentenced for terminating her pregnancy. She spoke after her release Tuesday.
I know I am no danger for society, and likewise, I know as well that my fellow women who remain in prison aren't dangerous to society either. And so I demand justice for them as well, so they can have that liberty that I have today.
El Salvador has long criminalized abortion with a total ban since 1998. Dozens have also been convicted and imprisoned after having miscarriages and stillbirths. And back in the United States, Democratic lawmakers are reintroducing the Women's Health Protection Act, which would prevent states from imposing restrictions on abortion. The move comes amidst mounting Republican attacks on reproductive rights and in the wake of the Supreme Court decision to hear a challenge to a Mississippi law that could threaten Roe v. Wade. This is Massachusetts Congressmember Ayanna Pressley speaking in support of the bill Tuesday.
In this moment, where anti-choice legislatures have made it clear that they will stop at nothing to ban abortion care, it is simply no longer enough to say that you are pro-choice. We have to proactively legislate racial and reproductive justice and meaningfully advance policies that affirm that abortion care is health care and that health care is a fundamental human right.
And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman in New York, joined by Democracy Now! Co-host Juan Gonzalez in New Brunswick, New Jersey. Hi, Juan.
Hi, Amy, and welcome to all of our listeners and viewers across the country and around the world.
A major leak of IRS tax filing has revealed new details about how U.S. billionaires pay little in income tax compared to their massive wealth, sometimes even nothing. ProPublica obtained the private tax records of some of the nation's wealthiest billionaires, and the findings are stunning. Between 2014 and 2018, the wealthiest 25 Americans saw their collective wealth jump by $400 billion, but they paid just over $13 billion in federal income tax. That's just 3.4% of their wealth increase. Warren Buffett paid a true tax rate of just 0.1% on income taxes during that period, while seeing his wealth grow by $24 billion. Jeff Bezos, the world's wealthiest man, paid no federal income taxes in 2007 or 2011. Elon Musk, the second richest person in the world, paid no federal income taxes in 2018. George Soros paid no federal income tax for 3 years in a row. And former New York City Mayor Michael Bloomberg also paid no income tax 1 year. The Biden administration responded to the explosive report by announcing a probe into who leaked the private IRS filings. Meanwhile, Senator Elizabeth Warren repeated her call for a wealth tax, saying, quote, "Our tax system is rigged for billionaires who don't make their fortunes through income like working families do. The evidence is abundantly clear. It's time for a wealth tax in America to make the ultra-rich finally pay their fair share," she said. In a moment, we'll be joined by the ProPublica reporter who, along with several others, broke the story. But first, we turn to a short video produced by ProPublica about the ultra-wealthy, how they avoid paying taxes.
Some of the very richest Americans pay little in taxes compared with how fast their fortunes grow each year. How? They use a tax strategy known as buy, borrow, die. It's like the ultra wealthy are living on another planet. Average people need income to pay for basics like housing and food. But the ultra wealthy don't. They can just live on borrowed cash. Step one, buy. The ultra-wealthy buy an asset or build a company or inherit a fortune. As long as they don't sell, they owe no taxes. They keep their income as low as possible, since every dollar they earn can be taxed. Step two, borrow. They borrow against their holdings and the bank gives them a really good deal.
I'll loan you $10 million with only 3% interest. But if you take a $10 million salary from your company, you'll owe almost 37% to the IRS.
So the ultra-wealthy use loan money to fund their lifestyles. That's how a billionaire can live the most luxurious life imaginable while reporting little to no taxable income. Step three, die. When they die, these lucky few often use complicated trusts and philanthropic foundations to avoid the estate tax. And their heirs can inherit stocks and other assets tax-free. A new generation is ultra-wealthy, and the cycle starts all over again.
That's a new video from ProPublica. We're joined now by Jeff Ernsthausen, senior data reporter there. He's co-author of the expose headlined The Secret IRS Files. Trove of never-before-seen records reveal how the wealthiest avoid income tax. Welcome to Democracy Now!, Jeff. It's great to have you with us. What a stunning report. I think it's always easiest to link with one person to understand this whole story, and the video is very good. But why don't you start with Jeff Bezos? And, I mean, this is a man, wealthiest in the world, who got a $4,000 child tax credit, is building a $500 million yacht. Can you explain how this system works?
Thank you for having me. So our story is about a relatively simple concept, which is that typical wage earners like you or me, we pay taxes every time we get a paycheck, right? It comes out automatically. But for the ultra wealthy, it's a completely different story. So they don't pay taxes until they decide to do something like sell a stock, at which point they're taxed on it. So this allows them to accrue massive amounts of wealth almost entirely outside of the tax system. And so the example of Jeff Bezos is a good one for illustrating this. So between 2006 and 2018, his wealth grew by almost $130 billion. During that time, he paid something on the order of $1.4 billion in taxes, which sounds like a lot, but it's almost a 1% on the amount that his wealth went up. And so in some years, he had a very, you know, would register very low income and therefore end up paying almost nothing in taxes. And in a couple of years, nothing in taxes.
And Jeff, I was most struck by the Warren Buffett's inclusion in this group, given how often Buffett has publicly decried the unfairness of the tax system. The fact that he is on a regular basis utilizing the benefits of being able to avoid paying taxes is really amazing. I wonder if you could talk about his situation in particular.
Yeah, Warren Buffett is sort of the one of the best examples of how this works. So Berkshire Hathaway sort of somewhat famously doesn't pay a dividend. And because of that, Warren Buffett's income as a major shareholder of Berkshire ends up being relatively low every year for someone with as much money as he has. And so his wealth is shot up by tens of billions of dollars in the 5-year period that we focus on in our story, and he paid in the millions in taxes, and that's because his company is structured in such a way that he's not ever really realizing any of those gains in a way that the U.S. tax system recognizes.
And what would be the ways that the government could be able to move into this whole area of wealth versus income in terms of, because obviously a lot of these ultra wealthy people like Michael Bloomberg and Soros and Buffett end up giving a lot of their wealth to foundations as a means for them actually to avoid paying even a wealth tax toward the end of their lives.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of the aspects of the system that, if nothing else, if you do donate your money to charity, there's not going to be a moment when those gains are taxed. So if you give stock to charity, for instance, you don't pay. It's not like you have to sell it and then take pay taxes on it and then give it to the charity. You get to give it to the charity and taxes are never paid on it. And while these foundations, they may do quite a bit of good in the world, it does sort of allow those who have a great deal of wealth to somewhat pick and choose what they contribute to, while normal everyday Americans are sort of paying into the general fund, if you will, of expenditures that the government makes.
I wanted to turn to a moment in Congress. Abigail Disney, the granddaughter of Roy Disney, the co-founder of the Walt Disney Company, recently testified on Capitol Hill in support of a wealth tax. She was questioned by Senator Elizabeth Warren.
If you don't mind my asking, how much wealth do you have and how much did it grow last year?
I have about $120 million, maybe more, depending on how the stock market is on any given day. It grows at about 4 to 8% annually.
Okay, thank you. And so let's just say, you said 4 to 8%. Let's just say an average growth of about 6%. That would mean that your wealth grew by about $7 million last year. That is almost 60 times the total wealth of the typical American family. So let's just for a minute talk about that increase. Do you know how much in taxes you will pay on your $7 million increase in wealth this year, Dr. Disney?
Not that much. It comes not from wages, but from things like dividends and capital gains and interest and so forth. So all of that qualifies for a lower tax rate than income.
All right. And what about your total $120 million fortune? How much do you think you'll pay in taxes on that this year?
Nothing. There's no wealth tax.
So that's Abigail Disney, the granddaughter of the co-founder of the Walt Disney Company, and that she was being questioned by Elizabeth Warren. The senator responded to the ProPublica investigation by tweeting, "Our tax system is rigged for billionaires who don't make their fortunes through income like working families do. The evidence is abundantly clear. It's time for a wealth tax in America to make the ultra-rich finally pay their fair share." Jeff Ernsthausen, can you explain what a wealth tax would look like and also how you calculated the true tax, as you called it, on these billionaires, of these billionaires?
Sure. So our article was focused on sort of putting out information that we think is important to inform the public debate. There are a number of proposals that people have made for how wealth taxes would work, although it wasn't sort of the focus of our article. And the way that we did our analysis, and it was something that couldn't obviously be done without having the tax information of these individuals, was to compare how much their wealth went up over a five-year period, according to Forbes, with how much they're paying in taxes. And that's really the key concept for these folks, because they're not bringing in a lot of money in wages and traditional income. They're bringing in money through things like capital gains, growth in stock value. And that really illustrates what matters most for them, which is how much their wealth grows each year.
And Jeff, I wanted to ask you, given that this individual tax information, the information of tax payers is generally considered a secret information not available to the public, and that you obtained some of these records. There's now criticism in some parts, especially among some Republicans, that this was somehow an illegal dump of information to you. How do you respond to the Biden administration concentrating now on trying to find out how this leak occurred rather than try to deal with what it reveals?
Well, obviously, we think it's important to inform a public debate about taxation and spending in this country, to know what the wealthiest Americans pay. And we're being very selective in what we are disclosing in our stories. So we think this is vitally important information to inform the public.
Spokesperson.
Disclosure of confidential government information by a person with access is illegal, and we take this very seriously. The IRS commissioner said today that they are taking all appropriate measures, including referring the matter to investigators.
So, again, that is White House spokesperson Jen Psaki. I think it's interesting. This comes right after the Biden administration and the Department of Justice promised they would not be investigating journalists. So maybe, Jeff, your email and other records will be safe if, in fact, this leak investigation goes on. But it's an interesting contrast between Senator Warren calling for a wealth tax and the Biden administration calling for a leak investigation.
Absolutely. And we're, of course, hoping that that the administration sticks to some of the rhetoric that we've heard in previous days and in recent previous days regarding that.
And finally, you have a number of articles here. It's a whole compilation of articles. You may be paying a higher tax rate than a billionaire. Explain.
Yeah, so we released two articles. One sort of focused on what we've discussed so far, which is this this tax rate on wealth growth. The other we focus on the sort of very traditional measure that the IRS often uses, which is taxes paid divided by income as the IRS recognizes it, and it's what a lot of people think of when they think of their tax rate. And the interesting thing is that even on that measure, the ultra wealthy pay less than a large swath of Americans because the income that they do take, it tends to be at the preferential rates like capital gains, and which is taxed at a lower rate than wages. So even on the sort of traditional measure, this group of the wealthiest Americans pays relatively little.
And what do you plan to do with all this information? You haven't released a lot of details. What are you doing over these months?
We're going to continue to write stories that are related to the information in here. You can expect a number of additional stories over the coming months based on this trove.
Jeff Ernsthausen, senior data reporter at ProPublica, co-author of the investigative series, which we will link to just out, headlined The Secret IRS Files, Trove of Never-Before-Seen Records Reveal How the Wealthiest Avoid Income Tax. Coming up, we'll look at the shocking treatment of migrant children in U.S. custody. Videos emerged of officials in Texas tasering a 16-year-old boy from Honduras.
Justicia tendrán, justicia verán en el mundo los desafortunados con el canto del tango la justicia yo reclamo. Justicia tendrán, justicia verán el mundo. Y los discriminados, recompensa ellos tendrán, no serán perjudicados. Si no hubiera tiranía, todos fuéramos hermanos, dulce paz y armonía, alegría.
Justicia, by Eddie Palmieri. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. The Biden administration's vowed to take a compassionate approach to migrants and asylum seekers who arrive at the U.S.-Mexico border after fleeing violence, poverty and persecution. But Vice President Harris drew outrage Monday when she told them, quote, not to come during a news conference on her trip to Guatemala to address root causes of migration. Harris has also come under fire for not yet visiting the U.S.-Mexico border. She was questioned Tuesday by NBC News anchor Lester Holt.
So this whole thing about the border, we've been to the border. We've been to the border.
You haven't been to the border.
I haven't been to Europe. And I don't understand the point that you're making.
This comes as a damning new investigation by Reveal examines what happens to migrant children who arrive at the U.S.-Mexico border and are placed in the custody of the Office of Refugee Resettlement, or ORR, and held in federally funded shelters. Reveal found more than 80 children were turned over from these shelters to local law enforcement when they engaged in behavior common for kids, especially those who've been through trauma. Many were arrested for fighting, breaking property, or mental health crises. In one case, Reveal tracked a boy who left Honduras to seek asylum in the U.S., who was in a shelter in San Antonio, Texas, when staff there called 911 to report he'd broken some bins and bed frames. Body cam footage obtained by Reveal shows a Bexar County Sheriff deputy tasering the 16-year-old. A warning. The video is disturbing, but the boy's grandmother wants it to be seen. So Reveal published it, and we show part of it to you now. You can hear the deputy speaking English to the boy, who speaks Spanish. The boy's tying the drawstring on his pants when he's tased for about 35 seconds straight.
All right. Ready? I'm going to tase his head.
Divers spoke to the boy in English.
Hey, step out of the way. Stand up.
Divers doesn't tell the boy he's under arrest.
No, turn around. I'll see what they look.
Turn around now.
Stop.
Divers shucks the child for about 35 seconds.
Where are you going to take me? Where are you going to take me? Tell me where you're taking me.
That's body camera footage of a sheriff in San Antonio, Texas, tasering a boy held in a federally funded shelter. The child remains in custody now. For more, we're joined by Aura Bogado. She's senior investigative reporter at Reveal, who's long covered immigration, including the conditions of detained migrant kids. Her new investigation with Laura C. Morell is headlined, "I'm Going to Tase This Kid. Government shelters are turning refugee children over to police." Welcome back to Democracy Now, Aura. Talk about this particular situation where this boy is held, supposedly moving them from Custom and Border Patrol facilities to ORR is supposed to be more humane, but then they bring in the police and they tase them?
Right. A lot of people within the federal government will usually refer to ICE and Border Patrol as enforcement and ORR, which really is an agency that should be a household name by now. Those are more social workers. And so these are children, minors, you know, under the age of 18 who are put in shelters. They're not accused of any crime, et cetera. And they're supposed to be put there under a federal consent decree and be taken care of in the least restrictive kind of facility until they can be released without unnecessary delay. We found over and over again that a lot of children are kept, you know, beyond a few weeks or beyond a few months and are transferred around for different reasons. We sued the government for the records regarding, just basic facts about the treatment of children, how long they're kept inside. We got about 300,000 records last year. And based on that, we started noticing that a lot of children were being discharged to law enforcement. And so we went, locale by locale and started asking for more records. We got a lot more records. In this particularly egregious case, we saw, as the audience just saw, that a child was tased soon after shelter staff called 911, and the local sheriffs there, which is the Bexar County Sheriffs, the one of the deputies deployed a taser, speaking to the child in English, although the child, you know, primarily speaks Spanish. And this is a child who's also fleeing some pretty intense violence in Honduras. He is pretty scared to go back. We were able to confirm his identity and also track down his family. And as you mentioned, they did think that it was important for people here in the United States to see this and to know how some children are treated in custody.
And Aura, in this particular case, you were also able to talk to Julie Tamez, I believe, who was listed in the records as the child's lead case manager. What did she tell you?
Yes, it's very rare to be able to speak with people who work in shelters. The government really that's part of the operation. And some of that is understandable. You want to be able to protect the rights and privacy of children. But we cold called the shelter, the number that we had. I was able to speak with her for some while, And she expressed a lot of regret for what happened. She was very sorry. She wanted the family to know that she was sorry for what happened that day. This was a very sort of different attitude than what we see later on in some of the video, where she's sort of, you know, going back and forth and talking with the deputies, suggesting that the child may be a hitman, of which we have no evidence of. You know, she told us by phone that she didn't mean to suggest that he was a killer, but that he had been placed somewhere where sometimes killers are placed. So it was an interesting, you know, disclosure on her end. But it's rare to be able to speak with people who work in shelters, and even rarer to be able to see the inside of a shelter and see what these places are like. This isn't exactly an unannounced visit from, you know, a legislator, but actual body cam footage. And so we were able to sort of see the inside of the kinds of places that we do a lot to get information about, and is often described to us either in records or by children who've been there in the past. In this rare case, we were able to sort of see the inside from this body cam footage.
And some people might say, well, maybe this was a unique case of a law enforcement person gone rogue here. But you were able to find records that there had been at least 19 police interventions with children. Could you talk about whether this is an unusual or outlier case, or whether there's a pattern?
Well, we know that at least 84 children have been turned over from shelters to local law enforcement. We did a lot to try and get records from individual police departments, individual sheriff's departments, and we were able to get 19 records, including the case of this child. What we found over and over and over again is that children are charged with misdemeanors. We only found one felony charge, and everything that we saw that was a felony assault charge, and that was dismissed. So over and over again, the cases are dismissed. The idea that a child, particularly a refugee child, someone who is fleeing violence and is a minor and has special rights under international law and U.S. law, would then be subjected to arrest for something like fighting, or in this case, allegedly breaking some plastic bins and some bed frames. That seems highly unusual, I think, to anybody that either has kids or is, we've all been kids. A lot of young people fight. That is not necessarily unusual for any population. And so we see that while this may be really egregious in terms of the level of force that was used, these arrests themselves are not that uncommon. And again, this is an agency that is funding these shelters with our money, with taxpayer money. And we can see that some of the treatment results in being handed over to a different agency, which is not a federal agency, but a local law enforcement agency. Often kids are just sent back into the system into a different shelter. But unfortunately, this kind of arrest, even for a misdemeanor, breaking a plastic bin, can result in a negative effect on an individual immigration case.
And very briefly, I mean, this happened before the Biden administration came in, but you requested information from Health and Human Services Secretary Javier Becerra. ORR is run by HHS. He didn't respond to your media requests. Can you talk about, for example, what happens with this boy and other kids? They can be moved from one of these shelters to another, and then ultimately, when they age out, they're deported?
Yeah, you know, children are in this agency, as you said, until the age of 18. They then become adults and are often taken by ICE and put into adult detention and deported afterwards. We did try over and over and over again to get not only comment from the department and from Secretary Becerra, but we also repeatedly, you know, said we were willing to share the video ahead of publication. This goes back to some while. And over again, the agency either stonewalled us or, you know, told us that they won't comment because they don't comment about anything to do with anonymous allegations. Our investigation is not based on anonymous allegations. Our investigation is based on data from that very department that we unfortunately had to litigate for under federal information Records Act, and then the local information that we received was also legitimately obtained from individual law enforcement. There's nothing anonymous here. These aren't allegations. We think also that the video speaks for itself, and there is a strong public interest in knowing what happened. And as a reporter, I feel that there's a strong public interest in this agency and Secretary Becerra responding for what happened here.
Aura Bogado, we want to thank you for being with us, senior investigative reporter at Reveal, co-author of the new article, which we'll link to at democracynow.org. I'm going to tase this kid. Government shelters are turning refugee children over to police. Oh, and congratulations, Aura, for recently winning the Hellman Prize for Web Journalism. Coming up, Takeover. A new documentary looks at how the Young Lords took over a hospital in the South Bronx in 1970. We'll also talk about the key role of our own co-host, Juan Gonzalez. Stay with us. Segura, and hooray for the riffraff. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. We look now at an extraordinary new documentary called Takeover that follows the 12 historic hours, July 14, 1970, when members of the Young Lords took over the rundown Lincoln Hospital in the South Bronx. The Young Lords were a radical group founded by Puerto Ricans modeled on the Black Panther Party. They drove out the administrative staff of the hospital, barricaded the entrances, made their cries for decent health care known to the world. This is the trailer to the film Takeover.
This is a story from New York. Not the New York of Manhattan Broadway, but from perhaps the toughest square mile in the city, in the South Bronx.
I was 14 years old when I joined the Young Lords. The Young Lords were a street gang that became politicized by the Black Panther Party.
We became visible as servants of the people.
One of our targets was Lincoln Hospital.
That building was condemned 25 years ago. Condemned for rich people and opened up for poor people.
It was a place that you went to die.
Lincoln was called the butcher shop.
Blood stains on the walls, blood stains on the floors.
And there was a rat in the emergency room.
We have seen children get lead poisoning while hospitalized at Lincoln Hospital.
We felt now is the time for us to say exactly how we're going to respond to the killings of our people.
Our plan was to take over Lincoln Hospital.
We have to begin to stand up as the people, the Puerto Rican people, and say that's enough, that's enough.
We have been asking for changes to take place, and you've paid no attention to us. You've thrown us out of your offices, and you've called the cops on us. And now we're putting you out. You've taken over a hospital. We're going to run it. You're out. and I will walk you to your car.
We immediately announced that we were not leaving until the city made a firm commitment to build a new hospital.
From El Barrio to Arecibo, Palante.
About 1,000 policemen en route with high-powered rifles. They had vans all over the place.
If the police came in, it was going to be a bloodbath because the police hated the Young Lords.
We were terrified.
To all who had to hide, I'd say, Palante.
Power to the people means, including people, to gain control of their destiny.
The Young Lords were ahead of our time in terms of recognizing that healthcare is a right.
We wanted a revolutionary change to the health system in this country, and we still do.
No oppressor, it's invincible.
The trailer to the film Takeover, and one of the voices and images you heard and saw was Democracy Now! Co-host Juan Gonzalez, co-founder of the Young Lords, who helped organize the action. In this clip from the film, we hear other Young Lords explain how the group started in New York. This is Felipe Luisiano, Miguel Mickey Melendez, and Denise Oliver Velez. We hear first from Iris Morales.
The Young Lords didn't drop from the sky one day and all of this happened. We were part of a continuum of history, of a legacy that had gone before us.
For that revolution within the United States, we see ourselves hooking up with Black people, with Native Americans, with Asians, with other Latinos to form a united front as oppressed people to wage against the real enemy.
I started out as a cadre in the Young Lords in 1969. I became Deputy Minister of Education. I was a co-founder of the Women's Caucus.
I was the first chairman of the Young Lords Party.
We are ideological in that we believe in the principles of socialism, in that we believe in cooperative effort, in that we believe in unified struggle.
It's all about pride, it's all about community, it's all about being together. I was one of the co-founders of the Young Lords organization in New York City.
When you joined to be a full Young Lord, you left home, you quit your job. If your family didn't, if you had a spouse or whatever that didn't want to be a part of it, you left them. So when we said you're a Young Lord 25 hours a day, we meant it. I became the first woman on the Central Committee of the Young Lords. We were coming from a place of love and of respect. But we also didn't take any shit.
That's from Takeover. Well, for more, we're joined by Emma Frances Snyder, the director of this new short documentary. The film premieres this Friday at the Tribeca Film Festival. It will be available to stream online starting Saturday. And, of course, we're joined right here by co-host Juan Gonzalez, co-founder of the Young Lords, who was one of those who took over the hospital. But, Emma, let's start with you on why you decided to focus on the Lincoln Hospital takeover and through it tell this remarkable story of the Young Lords through incredible archival footage, but also reenactments that look like they were archival footage.
First of all, thank you so much for having me. This is a dream come true, so thank you. You know, for me, the takeover really exemplified what the Young Lords were about. It was not only the biggest, like the largest takeover at the time, but it also had some very concrete, real results, which was essentially the new a new hospital, the Patient Bill of Rights, and ultimately a call for universal health care and community control. And for me, as a young activist that wanted to learn, this kind of started off as my own process of wanting to learn and understand about successful modes of direct action. And what I found at Lincoln Hospital was like this beautiful cross-section of life and collaborativeness that cut across socioeconomic and racial lines, and in which the community and the workers led and the doctors and residents followed. And I felt like it was just a really beautiful way that we saw, that I saw, for people to support and follow community control in a way that was really successful. And then on top of it, just as like a filmmaker, it's a beautiful story, right? There's, you know, we think of cops and robbers and heists of things that don't actually happen, but like there's so much emotion and planning and courage that comes along with direct action. And I really wanted to sit in those moments and exemplify like what it takes to do something like this, not just the planning, not just the thought leading up to it, but like the feelings. I mean, there was a face-off. They took over a building and there was a face-off with the police. I mean, it's just like, it is a story in and of itself.
Juan, it is an astounding story, and it's your story, Juan. Talk about why you chose Lincoln Hospital. What were the demands, and what these 12 hours once you marched in, the response of the hospital staff? I mean, operations are going on, et cetera.
Well, I think the reason we took the hospital is because we had been involved, and I think it's underappreciated the amount of work that the Young Lords did in what we would normally call today public health. It was not just the issue of the treatment in the hospital and the services in a dilapidated, rundown hospital that the city had been promising to tear down for decades but hadn't done, but it was also all of the work that we did in lead poison detection, tuberculosis detection, drug detoxification, acupuncture, using acupuncture for the first time in drug treatment that was developed by the Lords and the Panthers at Lincoln Hospital. That there was, in other words, health was a major, major concern of ours at the time. And but we understood that to get the system to listen and change, you had to disrupt it. You had to find a way to force people to pay attention to the problem. So I think that's the main thrust of all of our actions that we took in this wide area of public health at the time.
And one of the stories that Emma tells so well that you were involved with was the hijacking of a tuberculosis truck, if you could explain one.
Well, we wouldn't call it hijacking. We called it liberating, the liberating of a tuberculosis truck. That was the city was misusing and wouldn't provide in the East Harlem and South Bronx community. So we redirected the route of the truck in order to be able to test more people who were actually at the center of what was then a tuberculosis epidemic in the city. But I wanted to ask Emma, because Emma, you interviewed me, I guess it was about 10 years ago when you were first starting this project.
Yes.
And I have to tell you, I've been very impressed by the result of your work, especially in the recreations. Because for a while, when I first saw your final version, I thought you had somehow found footage of what we had done back then that I was not aware of. It turned out then that you basically had some actors recreate some of these scenes, but they were so well done. And even some of the characters resembled so much younger versions of Cleo Silvers or Carlito Rovira that I first thought that this was actually archival footage. I'm wondering about the decision to take that route in terms of telling the story.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that while this is a true story, I think that it also had, as I referred to earlier, it had all these cinematic elements, right? And it's like, what does it look like taking over a hospital? Like there is that drama, the tension. And I really wanted us, the audience, to live and breathe in those moments with you. Because so much of the time, things like this may get glossed over. And I just really wanted to sit in it and have the audience feel all of these feelings. I really have to credit the director, the cinematographer, Tine DeLucia. She and I worked together and really, you know, And honoring the third world newsreel movement at that time, honestly, like this is directly related to and taken the style taken from the work that was done. And so just referencing that.
Well, I want to go to another clip from the documentary Takeover. The voices include Juan Gonzalez, as well as the former New York mayor, deputy mayor, Sid Davidoff, under Lindsay. It begins with Pablo Guzman, known as Yoruba, the Young Lords Minister of Information, speaking to reporters during the takeover of Lincoln Hospital.
Yoruba, what's happened?
What's happened now is that while we were negotiating and while we were trying to reach some kind of a settlement, the first thing that we had come up with was that we would be clear and we would be free to negotiate as long as they moved the pigs back. They said they're going to move the pigs back, and while they were saying this, they tried to sneak a pig in to yank one of the lords out, to yank one of our brothers out. As this was going down, we then had to tell them, look, we know where you're at. This is a breach of good faith. We can't deal anymore. I'm going to have to leave now because they're trying to mobilize now, and I have to go deal.
We say, look, this is real simple. We don't resolve this with you right now. The next thing to come in is the guys with the guns. You don't want the guys with the guns coming in here.
The police hated the Young Lords, and they loved the opportunity to get us all in one place.
Because the Young Lords had seen the killing of Fred Hampton, the leader of the Chicago Black Panthers, by police officers, they had reason to be afraid.
We were terrified that they were going to come in there and they were going to beat us into pulp, and no one was going to help us.
Those last voices, Cleo Silvers and reporter Jeff Kamen, who are featured in the documentary Takeover. Juan, I mean, let's talk about that time. What you faced as you're moving into this hospital. Yes, this was about half a year after the police murder of Fred Hampton and Mark Clark in Chicago. You didn't know if you would be shot, if you would be arrested, if you would be killed.
Well, I think... The lesson of this for us then, and I think for activists today, is that we were trying to negotiate with the Lindsay administration, which is ostensibly a liberal Republican in those days. There aren't any liberal Republicans today, but back then there were some. And the question was really, to what degree did the mayor of the city control his own police department? And it became increasingly clear as we negotiated that he didn't really control the police department, and that the police department had a mind of its own. And so we had to deal with the reality that even if we wanted to negotiate, the Lindsay administration did, the police department had other ideas. So we had to take that into account in trying to figure out what to do at that stage. Once we had spread the message throughout the city and the country about the occupation and the issues involved. And so we chose at a certain point, after getting a verbal commitment from the administration, that if we left, and if we they couldn't announce anything at the time, but if we left the hospital, that they would indeed build a new Lincoln Hospital. And they did build a new Lincoln Hospital shortly thereafter. But we then had to decide to either have a complete standoff and many people injured or hurt, or figure out a way to get out of the hospital while the police surrounded it. I think Emma did a very good job in terms of telling the story of how that happened.
And it, that amazing
and that miraculously
escape.
No one was hurt, and we all managed to get out. No one was arrested.
And that amazing escape in white coats was incredible. Emma, we just have 10 seconds. How do people get to see this film at the Tribeca Film Festival and beyond?
You can watch it virtually. We are all of our screenings are sold out. So if you just go to the Tribeca website, Takeover 2021, thank you so much for having me.
Well, Emma Frances Snyder, director of the new short film Takeover. It premieres Friday at the Tribeca Film Festival. And Juan, amazing. That does it for the show. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. Thank you so much for joining us. Stay safe.